Honorable Deputy Speaker, sir. I stand here today to participate in the discussion moved by the motion of my friend Sri Rakesh Singh, motion of thanks on the President's address. Those four lines of the motion, the key word is, we are deeply grateful to the President for the address which he has been pleased to deliver in both Houses of Parliament assembled together on January 29. We have to express our deep gratefulness to the Honourable President. As the address itself is the policy statement of this government, therefore, we always delve into the policy that this government has been propounding during last so many years. But what has happened this year is that on 29th, the Honorable President delivered the speech, addressed both the houses. And on 1st of February, the Finance Minister has delivered the budget. So therefore, today you must have encountered the large number of members who have spoken before me. They have intertwined the address of the Honorable President along with the speech of the Finance Minister. I have tried to confine, myself only with the speech of Honorable President, because we will be discussing for about 12 hours, hopefully, on the budget itself. And before I delve into the specific paragraphs, I have selected some points for my deliberation. But before I go into this paragraph, one thing that struck me in the central hall is relating to what he mentioned about Adivasi Swatantrata Sangram Sangrahalaya. We have seldom deliberated, discussed the fight that our tribal people have fought during the freedom struggle. Very rarely we have put up memorials for them. But at least in this speech, something has been mentioned. How it is going to be developed is the what we will see in future course of action. But one thing, whether it is in Kevadia, Gujarat, on the banks of Narmada, where the beginning will start, but proposal of Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, Manipur, and other states are also under consideration. I am reminded of the struggle in Odisha, in Sundargarh, today's Sundargarh district and erstwhile Bonai state. The British soldiers wanted to recruit tribals for the Second World War. And the tribals who were forcefully being drawn to be recruited, they registered. And there was a large-scale firing. Hundreds of tribals were butchered. It is called Amko Simko agitation. And the leader was Nirmal Munda. A group of people even today observe that martyrdom day. Very rarely the government machinery is involved in it. But my question here is, is it only confined to the Munda tribe? Odisha government, of course, is doing something for that. But here is a case where the union government also should come in and support to erect a memorial and support annual festival over there. There was a tribal leader in his middle age. He had never seen Gandhiji, never heard Gandhiji, but he was so committed to the ideals what Gandhiji had propagated. He struggled, led an agitation for Quit India movement. He was hauled up by the police A false case was put against him. And in 1943, he was hanged to death, Lakshman Naik. We observe his martyrdom day, but he seldom finds place in the national history of freedom struggle. These are the people which we have to find out, and we have to commemorate their sacrifice. Sir, and I would like to remind this house that Lakshman Naik was the only freedom fighter who was hanged to death in 1942. Honorable President has said nation building is a continuous process. Every citizen of the country has a role to play. Wise words, no doubt about it. Benjamin Franklin had commented once that a republic, if you can keep it. It was as much a comment on ability as it was on intent. Today I may say, republic was easy to form even in those turbulent years when this country attained freedom. But we are finding it difficult to sustain. Republic has to be sustained in content. Our founding fathers have gave us a republic constitution, but they hoped that a civic rule necessary for republicanism to strike roots. Didn't Dr. Ambedkar warn that however good a constitution may be, it is sure to turn out bad because those who are called to work it are a bad lot. Did he not refer to elected representatives alone? He did not refer to elected representatives alone, but to the incomplete project of transforming people into citizens. The concern Honorable President expressed while speaking to nation on the eve of this year's Republic Day, and subsequently while addressing the joint session of both the houses the other day, is that, and I quote, "It is our responsibility to exhibit exemplary conduct before the nation. Nation building is our collective responsibility," unquote. These are the words of the Honorable President. What we see today, what we have heard today, majoritarianism, rise of vigilantism, institutional corrosion, a democracy get converted into shows of numerical strength, the capacity to negotiate and deliberate drowns under the noise of numbers. This gives way to anarchic articulation of vigilantism, rejecting the idea of rule of law. I need not explain what has happened in between. Some members have already done that. Both a cause and an effect of this is the all-round corrosion of institutions. Don't we find a competition, and this is the sad part of it, sir. Don't we find a competition among institutions to display their flair for failure? Honorable President, in his address, has reminded the nation about working towards achieving robust and inclusive development. Niti, in Hindi we call it Niti Aayog, was formed by the present government when it came to power in 2014 by dismantling Planning Commission. Idea was that it will facilitate the states and union to formulate their own plans and program. It will act as a think tank. I would not comment today what tank it has become. But now it is behaving in arbitrary way, and there they are insulting the states. A glaring example of identifying 115 districts as the most backward districts and asking the state government to sign MOUs with Niti, to which Odisha, Kerala and West Bengal have protested. This is distribution. There is distribution of power as per constitution, which is not in the domain of union government. Why would this government unilaterally declaring some districts as most backward and send Prabhari, where this word comes up? From where? We have heard Prabhari in some organizations. We have heard Prabhari that they are being deputed by his respective political parties. But Prabhari is from the Niti, from the union government, going to the state. Who has coined this word? And you are sending Prabhari to monitor the development work in the state districts, thereby bypassing the chief secretary and other elected departmental secretaries. What is happening in this country? These 115 districts include 30 districts which are focused by Niti Aayog. Another 50 backward districts selected by an inter-ministerial committee of officers. Another 35 districts which have been shortlisted by Ministry of Home Affairs, which are affected by left-wing extremism. Where are the states? Neither they have been consulted, nor any inputs were sought from the states. So much so about the so-called, Kalyan has just left, cooperative federalism. I think my friend Jitendra Reddy will talk about it. Odisha has not participated in this adventure. So also Kerala. So also West Bengal. Take the case of Bundelkhand. Only one district of that region have been included in this area, in this idea, in UP. It is a state ruled by BJP. And this demonstrates the lackadaisical manner in which these districts have been selected. And now it finds place in the budget speech of Finance Minister. No BJPCM or government has the spine to raise objection to this harakiri of the Constitution. What we believe, Biju Janata Dal, is that when you keep people first, it is good politics. My Chief Minister, leader of Biju Janata Dal, Mr. Naveen Patnaik, says, when you keep people first, there is no anti-incumbency. Half a century ago, one of the greatest visionary leader, Martin Luther King Jr., had said, you cannot lead people unless you love them. This is, to him, is the guiding political philosophy. If you love your people, you do not see the post you hold as a post, but as a means to serve the people. You do not see power as power, but as a means to transform the lives of people. All the negative associates of politics. These are the words which my Chief Minister has said. Power, wealth and position dissolve into nothingness if you love the people. If you work for the people, even in the worst natural disaster, you aim for zero casualty and you end up setting global standards. If you love your people, you do not want anyone without a roof over your head, over their head, and you end up leading the country in rural housing. If you love your people, you will walk the extra mile to include the most vulnerable sections in your growth story, and you end up with the path-breaking initiative of setting up tribal development council. If you love your people, you don't want hungry stomachs staring into the night. And you end up with the highest poverty reduction in the country. And if you love your people, you don't fight for elections. You fight for change and transformation. If you love your people, with every intent, every step, every action, every signature, and with every breath, you will work for them. That is the reason why Odisha stands apart from many of the states, especially those that are ruled by the Treasury bench. Many ministers go to Odisha saying that 18 saal ho gaya, 17 saal ho gaya, kya hua hai? Kya hua hai? I'll just give some instances, sir. Rural housing. 14 lakh pakka houses have been constructed in rural Orissa since 2014. And this is the source of Rural Development Ministry of Government of India. Odisha, the pioneering state in India, which has distributed 6,11,000 acres of land to 4,11,000 individuals, rights, title holders, and 3,28,000 acres of land to 5,964 community rights title holders under the landmark legislation of the Scheduled Tribe and other traditional forest dwellers as on 31st October 2017. And this is from a report from the Ministry of Tribal Affairs of Government of India. We started a Mamata program. Subsequently, year before last, the Janani program was initiated by the Union Government. It is a flagship program of the government, Odisha government, which was launched in 2011 and has benefited more than 30,57,000 women in the state, supporting the pregnant women. 5,63,000 self-help groups with more than 67 lakh women have been formed under Mission Shakti. Based on NSSO's Situation Assessment Survey for 2012-13 and 2002-2003, farmers' income doubled in real income terms. Radha Mohan ji, dhara dhyan se suniye. Humne double kar liya hai. Odisha is the top performer with a CAGR of 8.3%. And this is, the source is NSSO Situation Assessment Survey of 2012-13. और भी करना बाकी है, और भी आगे जाना है. PDS contribution, Odisha is the third highest contributor for food grain procurement in the country in the year 2015-16. It contributes 10.28% of the total procurement in the country. It contributes 36 lakh metric ton in the year 15-16. This contribution was only 2.07% in 2002-2003. And this is, the source is from a Lok Sabha start question of 26th April 2016. Poverty has declined. As per household consumer expenditure data of NSS, National Sample Survey, up to 2011-12, poverty in Odisha rural has declined by 24.6%. And this is household consumer expenditure data. Is tarah agar ek ek karke different parameters ko hum jaye, kafi jankari milega. Aur jo jaake wahan political stunt ke hisab se kehte hain ki 17 saal se kya hua hai, Navin Patnaik ji ne karke dikha diya, Biju Janata Dal ne karke dikha diya. Aur isiliye incumbency is not a factor, because we do our work because we love our people. GDP, Odisha's GDP growth rate was 7.94% in 2016-17, in comparison to India's GDP growth rate of 7.1 in that same year. But there are other issues which needs to be flagged, and one major issue is Mahanadi. Pichle सेशन में हमने बार बार यही कहा, रिक्वेस्ट किया, प्लीड किया, आर्ग्यू किया, ट्रिब्यूनल बनाइए. और मेरा पूरा सम्मान है, आज जो वाटर रिसोर्सेस मंत्री हैं वो कर पाएंगे, पर मालूम नहीं व्हाई ही वाज एडवाइज्ड इन सच अ वे, बट एटलीस्ट ही कमिटेड हिमसेल्फ इन दिस हाउस दैट हां, 3 महीने में हम ट्रिब्यूनल बनाएंगे. Matter was pending in the Supreme Court. You had given an affidavit saying, going back on your words, that yes, we will form a tribunal. But again, you gave an affidavit in the Supreme Court saying, it is not feasible. Yahan phir kaha, hum 3 mahine mein banayenge. Aur Supreme Court ne kya kaha? On 23rd January 2018, सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कहा 1 महीने में ट्रिब्यूनल बना के आओ. आज हो गया 6 तारीख, what progress has been made. Mahanadi river water dispute, on which the apex court has already pronounced its decision, admonished this government for going back on its word to form the tribunal and have asked this union government to do it within 1 month's time. This was pronounced on 23rd January. Today is 6th February. How many days have passed? Today is the 15th day, to be precise. Has any step been taken? Does not this show the brazenness in which the government treats the pronouncement of the Supreme Court of India? Does not this demonstrate the partisan attitude of this government towards Odisha? We will wait for the decision of the tribunal. We are sure it will give a decision in our favour because of the illegality of the construction of the upstream of Mahanadi by Chhattisgarh. But Union government, which was expected to function in a neutral way, is becoming partisan. Why don't you form the tribunal? Why do you wait for a single unitary tribunal which is still in the womb? Whom are you befooling? Chief Minister, on 2nd February, has again written a letter to the Prime Minister. There is no response. And I can only plead in this House for the wisdom of all members that is this the way the Union government should function? Is this the way how partisan you have to become just because you are going to face an election in some months' time in Chhattisgarh? Illegally, dams have been constructed. Illegally, water has been stopped. And Odisha is being bereft. What are we asking for? We are asking for a tribunal. At least tribunal will give a judgment. We'll hear both the sides, which we had pleaded before the Union government. Don't be partisan. You take a decision. The previous minister said, I have no power. At least now Supreme Court has given you instruction. As per the constitutional provision, a tribunal has to be formed. But I am sorry to mention, it is yet to proceed. We have heard about triple talaq in the address of Honorable President. He expressed hope that the bill be passed. He will act as per the aid and advice of his Council of Ministers. Triple talaq bill has already been passed by this House, and it goes against the verdict of Supreme Court. Talaq-e-bidat is unconstitutional. There is a need to have a law pronouncing talaq-e-bidat as unlawful. We are not against that. But the bill which is pending in Rajya Sabha needs thorough correction. That bill to do away with instant talaq is on the way of instant law. Law made in a hurry is bound to be faulty. Can't you incorporate in the nikahnama that the talaq-e-bidat is not allowed? Can't a separation, divorce be on record? If marriages fail, should government jail husbands? Marriages are social contract. There should always be attempt for reconciliation. If the husband is put behind bars on the complaint alone, will there be any scope of reconciliation? The bill is meant to protect the interest of Muslim women. Have they been consulted in any form before the preparation of this bill, which is a must as per the provision before lawmaking? Any law, before it is made, has to be consulted with the respective stakeholders. That is the practice and the provision of the Constitution. You have prepared a bill which is half-baked. This will bring more disaster to the women folk of Muslim community than empowering them. I fail to understand why you are doing it. Congress committed a mistake in 1986, and now you are committing another mistake. Correct it and bring in the amendment. Remove the penal provision. Don't become adamant. My friend Jitendra Reddy has come out openly about simultaneous election, about which Honorable President has spoken. And Honorable Prime Minister has also expressed his views positively. The young other Prashad, Ravi Shankar Prashad from Bihar, we had Dr. Prashad from Bihar. From Bihar, our law minister is going around the country saying we should debate. I may remind Mr. Reddy, my friend, that all this talk of simultaneous elections started from the dinner table that both of us shared once with the Honourable Prime Minister. It has rolled on since 2014, where you also, Honourable Deputy Speaker, sir, also were present. In different forums, Election Commission has also come out with an opinion. And what is Election Commission's opinion? Article 83, Article 85, Article 172, 174, and 356 of the Constitution need to be amended for fixing Lok Sabha and Assembly terms. If today it has found place in the address of Honourable President, should not we be told about the government's view? Why don't you prepare a draft and circulate it? Aaj to zamana ho gaya social media. Sarkar ka kya mat hai? What is your opinion? You are asking others to debate and discuss. But why don't you come out with a draft? Let that be the basis on which discussion will be there. Standing committee earlier had given a report. If you want further discussion on this issue, let us understand what the government intends to do. Why don't you prepare a draft and circulate it, basing on which discussion, debate will occur? What is the point of this wishful thinking? Honourable President, when you will be speaking, Honourable President mentioned about the presence of heads of states and government of ASEAN countries during this year's Republic Day celebration. It is indeed a special dimension to our world vision. But does it end here? What I have understood is that the principal gain of the ASEAN-Indian Commemorative Summit is to provide ample clarity on what our partnership has achieved and where it should move in the future. As the celebrations and colourful spectacles have ended, isn't it time to begin the hard work? When you stand at the peak of a mountain, you get full view of the path travelled and the road ahead that will take you to the next peak. It is now time to draw a to-do list. Have you prepared it? You have a huge responsibility to shoulder. The Republic crumbles, sir.
Okay.
When statesmanship stops at showmanship, politics breeds fear. Institutions fail to strengthen norms and procedures. Recently, we celebrated our 68th Republic Day. 7 decades of enjoying the Republic, the fortresses of community have become more impenetrable. In today's India, nobody can criticize, comment, or censure the practices of another community of which she or he is not part of. Communities are beyond debate and criticism. Relations among communities are also marked by mutual suspicion. Caste community-based separation, suspicion, and violence ensure that the idea of citizenship becomes a chimera. Then how can we conceive the idea of public good that would emerge and sustain in a republic? That is the fundamental question before us today. Given the fragmentation of the public and impossibility of common good, all politics and policy making is taking the form of a cynical exercise of balancing competing expectations. Serious casualty in this process is the loss of the idea of common good, which is at the core of a republic. Does this government has any roadmap to build in citizenship, collective responsibility, and strive for common cause and public good? The answer is there for everyone to see. How social justice and economic democracy can strengthen is pouring out in all newspapers daily. Last suggestion, sir, that I would like to make today is our constitution is instructive. Can we make a reading of this text a compulsory in classrooms across the country? This is the gospel. Constitution is the gospel. Constitution is the Gita. Constitution is the Quran of modern Bharat. Sasakta Bharat. Samruddha Bharat. Vande Utkal Janani. Jai Hind. Jai Jagannath.
Sri Anand Rao, Atsal.